So first I want to say good evening to everyone. Good evening. My name is Greg Bridges. I'm with KPFA Radio. And it's an honor to be one of the witnesses for this evening's discussion between two of the premier freedom fighters of our time. And I sincerely thank each and every one of you who made it out to be a part of tonight's event. We also have to give thanks to our host venue, Geoffrey's Inner Circle. And its owner, Geoffrey P., for ensuring that we continue to have a place to gather, whether it's for serious discussions and actions or for celebrations and frivolity. As we see the complexion and landscape around us taking on change, it's comforting to know that Geoffrey's remains a place for Black folk to fellowship in the various ways that we do. So big up to Geoffrey's. Now, we do have some voices that I know you all came to hear and some thoughts that I know you all came to be a part of tonight. But before we get to that, we cannot proceed without our libations. So let's give a welcome to Sister Mutima Imani for the libation.
Waiting on, and these two men have come to bless us. So I want you to, with me, begin to prepare your mind so that your heart can hear what you need to hear to do what you've been called to do. Because ain't no time like this time, and we are the ones. So I'm going to call in the libations by honoring the direction. And those of you who feel that power, stand up with me and face the north. And raise your right hand. Ancestors!
Ancestors.
From the north!
From the north!
Come and be with us!
Come and be with us!
On this auspicious moment!
On this auspicious moment!
Bring the wisdom through these two men.
Bring the wisdom through these two men.
To speak to our hearts.
To speak to our hearts.
To give us the charge.
To give us the charge.
To save our own lives.
To save our own lives.
And the whole planet.
And the whole planet.
Ashe.
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 Ancestors from the east.
Ancestors from the east.
Come and be with us.
Come and be with us.
Allowing us to know who we really are.
Allowing us to know who we really are.
Let us stand and tell the truth.
Let us stand and tell the truth.
And tonight, let us hear the truth.
Tonight, let us hear the truth.
Let us go inside and know that we are examples of life beautifully. I kneel here honoring Mother Earth and thanking her for all she does for us. Our food, our shelter, our clothing. Let us come out of the white supremacist mind to think that we can destroy the earth.
That's right.
We are one with her.
That's right. Yes.
And we thank her for allowing us to walk on her the way that we do. We know we are heavy, but we thank you, Mother. Father Sky, we open to your vastness, to your clarity. Let us go to the mountaintop and be like an eagle, strong. And let us remember that we are like hummingbirds. Touch your heart. Think of something that you love. Someone, someplace. Love is the healing salve, my sisters and brothers. And when we come together loving Black men and Black women, that is what's going to save this planet. Breathe in that love and send it around the room. And Marvin.
And.
Cornel, please stand right here for a minute. Come stand up. Right hand on your heart, left hand towards these two brothers. Face them. Face the audience. And say with me, if you will, and if you're willing. We love you.
We love you.
We're proud of you.
We're proud of you.
We know who you really are.
We know who you really are.
Angels in disguise.
Angels in disguise.
Example of love in action for
you. Example of love in action.
And we bless this water. This is our libation. Please take a sip. Please take a sip. Ashe!
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 Ashe! Ashe!
Thank you. We love you!
Thank you, Sister Matima. We welcome up now to sing our Black National Anthem, Ryan Foley.
Gotti, how's everyone this evening? My name is Brian Bowling. It's an honor to be here this evening to offer the Black Negro National Anthem written by James Johnson and Roland Johnson. And we got Brother Cornel West and Brother Marvin X here. It's going to be a wonderful evening, and I'm just honored to be here.
Lift every voice and sing. Till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmony of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the lifting skies. Let it resound loud as the roar.
Justice and the overall human rights of Black people in their own neighborhoods and communities, as well as around the world. Marvin X, one of the founders of the West Coast Black Arts Movement, has published over 30 books of essays, poems, and plays that often are commentaries on the precarious relationships Black people have with America, and those relationships we have with each other, and two lasting examples being his play One Day in the Life, the play he wrote about drug addiction and recovery, which became the longest-running African-American drama in Northern California, and his book, How to Recover from Addiction to White Supremacy. Marvin has been honored by the City and County of San Francisco with the Marvin X Day. He's also a life member of the California Scholarship Federation Honor Society, a recipient of the National Endowment for the Arts Writing Fellowship, and also a National Endowment for the Humanities Planning Grants. And one of Marvin's current endeavors is establishing a Black Arts District here in Oakland, a well-needed and well-deserved Black Arts District. Yeah. Dr. Cornel West, one of the leading philosophers in the nation, is also one of our nation's biggest social critics and political activists. Dr. West has written over 20 books, including his best-known titles, Race Matters and Democracy Matters, and he's edited 13 others. With a passion to communicate,
Cornel West has also shared his philosophies through music and spoken word recordings, collaborating with Prince, Jill Scott, Andre 3000, Talib Kweli, KRS-One, and the late Gerald LaVert. He's also been featured on productions by trumpeter Terrence Blanchard and others. Our moderator this evening is one of the most powerful voices on the airwaves. She's literally put her freedom on the line, protesting for our justice, organizing against police violence. She co-founded the Anti-Police Terror Project and served as executive director for the Bay Area National Lawyers Guild. She also became an organizer for Black Lives Matter and was a candidate for mayor of this city of Oakland.
That's right.
And on the next election, she'll be the mayor of the city of Oakland. So, to get tonight underway, let's give a great big welcome to our moderator, Kat Brooks. And tonight's featured speakers. And let's welcome up tonight's featured speakers, Marvin X and Dr.Cornel West. Before we get into our question and answer session with Marvin X and Dr.Cornel West and Kat Brooks, let's welcome up Dr. Iovaley and Zynga.
Everybody. It's so wonderful to see so many black faces out and about, so many civically engaged people who showed up to get their news. So it is my great pleasure tonight to welcome you to the band. We give thanks to our host, Geoffrey's Inner Circle, which is one of the anchor institutions in Oakland's only formally declared cultural district. The Black Arts Movement Business District. The district in Oakland was founded in January of 2016 by city resolution. Geographically, the district spans from 10th Street to 18th Street, from Lake Merritt to the 880 Frontage Road. It is a huge swath of geography that does something that historically has not been done in this town. It takes away the bifurcation between the lower bottoms and downtown, which has always been in West Oakland. So it actually heals West Oakland, which is rather historic. A great step towards equity, one might think, to have control of such a large swath of real estate. The resolution establishing this district is beautifully written, very, very aspirational. It talks about revitalizing formerly marginalized spaces. It takes off on AB 189, which is the state bill, which recognizes arts districts. And since 2016, our municipality has done nothing to celebrate this district. There are no banners.
That's right.
There is no signage.
That's right.
And many of you who may frequent this part of town may in fact just heard tonight that such a district exists. Right. There may be others of you who wonder about an organization called Band CDC. The CDC stands for Community Development Corporation. I founded BAM CDC in April of 2016 because I said from the very beginning, if cultural districts are to save people of color, if cultural districts are to recenter Oakland as a cultural mecca, then it could not be a Negro museum. It could not be a top-down thing created by the city to create a tourist district that bled black artists and black activists and black people. If they declared a cultural district, I thought we might have a chance for a Hail Mary. I thought that perhaps they'd identified where the battlefield was.
That's right.
So I decided that the only way a cultural district could be of any possible use to any of us on the ground is if it were a hybrid district, envisioned and animated by community and facilitated by the municipality here in Oakland that talks a lot aspirationally about equity.
That's right.
As we bleed black folk, as we bleed black businesses, as venues close, as the number of people sleeping on the street continue to pile up without compassion or care. I've been saying since 2011 that ethnic cleansing is afoot in Oakland. You know, there are many things you don't say until somebody gives you permission to say it. In the future, they'll tell you that we migrated, but we're here today. We know that we are being priced out. We know that development in Oakland does not benefit us all equally. And I see people in this room that have been on the ground building for decades. Why wouldn't this boom benefit you too? So hybrid district organized around pillars. We're a very siloed city. We have excellent people taking care of police violence. We have people who are concerned with the homeless. We have people who create policy. BAM CDC is organized around five pillars because I recognize our problems as being comprehensive and systemic and interwoven. And we have to harness all the energy we have in these very siloed places to make sure that we are concerned about housing, about commerce, about the importance of art and culture, about access to vital human services, and about the collection, proliferation of research and data, because research and data inform policy. Yes. BAM CDC is organized around those five pillars. If you would like to be a part of building out the district in which we sit, it doesn't matter whether you're a business person, if you consider yourself to be political, if you are a scholar, if you are an artist, if you are an individual citizen, it's everybody's business.
That's right.
And it's time to go now. You remember the song, Tell Me When to Go? It's time to go. It is time to stand up and push back unless you are willing to go home and pack. It is time to go. So, there'll be some clipboards passing around at some point this evening that invite you to sign up to get more information about BAM CDC, to find out about how to help with BAM Fest, a huge festival that's coming up in the middle of Black August to celebrate the Black Arts Movement here in Oakland. So, once again, welcome to the BAM! Program, and we're going to go straight into introductions to get us back on schedule, so I get to stay some more. I get the great pleasure of introducing Elmuhajir, Marvin Jagman, Marvin X. I could have read you the bio of Amiri Baraka.com. He was born in Fowler, little city, of Fresno, 1944. He's a prolific writer. You heard Greg Bridges say that he's written over 30 books. Might interest you to know at least 20 of them have been in the last decade. Mm. He is a magnetic speaker. He has mentored many, many people, and some of those people he led to water and they drank. Might be a few thirsty horses, man. He's a Gemini, so there are two of him. How well you like him may depend on which one you met first.
That's right.
Man is an intellectual genius.
Yes.
And he is an accessible genius. He has an academy on the corner of 14th and Broadway, and he sets up church there whenever he gets ready to.
Lakeshore Avenue.
Somewhat like Socrates, just sitting out and handing out knowledge to anybody willing to engage. Marvin X has introduced me to some of the greatest minds, some of the most mind-blowing freedom fighters, living and dead, that this room can imagine. I've had the pleasure of meeting Dr. West before. That's a rock star, y'all. When I was getting my graduate degree, I said, I want to grow up and be like Cornel West. Other rock stars like Nathan Hare.
That's right.
Julia Hare.
That's right.
I've met artists like Sonia Sanchez.
That's right.
Nikki Giovanni.
Yes.
Ishmael Reed.
Yes.
Sam Greenlee.
Yes.
Donnell Lee. Yes. Maybe most notably, Marvin's most significant partner in crime, Amiri Baraka. The two of them are especially significant when said in one breath, because we envision the foundation of the Black Arts Movement. A movement that I tell you on paper ended in 1970. Well, I was raised by lions, so I get to drop science on you. Never let your oppressor tell you when your movement's in. I create the continuum of the Black Arts Movement. I see others in the room that do as well. So it actually never ended. Maybe it just buried itself a little bit more deeply underground, because it is the sister to the Black Power Movement. And perhaps it's merely sleeping, waiting for a pregnant time, like right about now, to be joined by the power that it needs to walk in a room. It's very popular now to say that Black Lives Matter. Black Power matters. Because if you got power, you ain't got to tell nobody your life matters.
That's right. That's right.
I was raised by lions, Marvin X. Marvin X has mentored me. He's counseled me. He didn't cuss me out. He's prayed for me. He's prayed with me. One of my favorite little anecdotes about him is his mother was a wonderful woman, very, very wise, very socially forward, who loved her son and told him how brilliant he was, how he was a giant amongst men, but he had one fatal flaw. He just wouldn't leave them niggas alone. And I personally am extremely grateful that on that note, that he didn't listen to his mother. Ladies and gentlemen, it's with the greatest pleasure that I can possibly muster that I introduce my mentor, El Muhajir, Marvin X.
Yeah, yeah.
So now I guess I'll bring up your grandson, and after that, you can introduce Dr. West.
Grandson, come on up. Thank you, Ayo.
Hello, greetings. My name is James Rhodes, and I'm the grandson of Marvin X. Today, I'm proud to introduce Dr.Cornel West, one of the most prominent and provocative intellectual philosopher, political activist, and social critics of today. In 2017, I had the pleasure of taking Dr. West's course titled The Historical Philosophy of W.E.B. Du Bois during my sophomore summer at Dartmouth College in New Hampshire. All right. Every class meeting was highlighted by Dr. West's enthusiasm for teaching and devotion to discussing and challenging some of the most pressing issues facing society today, such as race, gender, and socioeconomics. We became familiar with W.E.B. Du Bois, one of the most cosmopolitan figures of the 20th century, as we read classics such as The Souls of Black Folk and Dusk of Dawn. Dr. West geniusly contextualized Du Bois' philosophy of double consciousness, or what it means for a black person to experience a bipolar reality forced by simultaneously existing in constrained white and black social spaces. Dr. West's captivating ability to spark profound thought on complex topics in order to bring about understanding provided everyone in the class with an opportunity to speak about and internalize essential issues about what it means to be human, what it means to be an American, and what it means to have an identity.
All right.
This class played a pivotal role in shaping my college experience. As a history major, Dr. West's continued dedication to humanities and the education system served as a point of adding depth to my understanding about how others perceive themselves in the world and how people with different backgrounds interact with themes that impact everyone through commonalities. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Cornel West.
Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
That's town business. Thank you. I'm really looking forward to this conversation, as I know all of you are too. Thank you so much for being here. Quick point of order before we get started, though. You heard Ayodele speak about the fact that the town is bleeding black people. We now have less than 25% black people in this city. And the vast majority of the 6,000 to 9,000 people that are sleeping on our streets are formerly housed black people. There's a war being waged on black life. And you have two options when someone wages war on you. You can die, or you can fight back. And this is town. This is the town, and what we do here is fight back. And so I just want to take a brief moment, and I want to honor a warrior in this fight. Dominique, can you just put your hand in there? Folks, look back there. That's Dominique. One of the founders of Moms for Housing. If you haven't heard about Moms for Housing, they are a brave group of mothers who said that they were not going to allow their children to sleep on the streets anymore, and they took a vacant property, a property that's in my district, in my hood, West Oakland, that's been sitting vacant for years. As a matter of fact, for every one homeless person in this city, there are four vacant properties.
Wow. So
they took it exactly. So they took the house, the company, the multi-billion dollar global company, Wedgwood, has given them an eviction notice, and the sheriffs are coming for these black mothers on the 17th. Whatever you can think of to do between now and then, and especially on that day, I call on you to do it. It is literally about the life and death of black bodies in the city. Thank you, Dominique. We honor you, your work, the work of the mothers. You have the spirit of everything. Okay. Now let's get down to it. So, if you know anything about these brothers, these kings to my left and to my right, you know that they are brilliantly verbose. And we've got a lot of things we want to talk about tonight, right? We want to talk about national politics, we want to talk about housing, we want to talk about police and policing. So I'm going to try, they both told me that it probably won't work, but I'm going to try to time them. We'll see what happens. So, to kick us off, each of you have 5 minutes for your opening remarks. I'm gonna set my little tower on my phone so we'll all collectively hear the ding 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 ding, and then we'll know, right, if they're gonna play along or not. I may just be furniture this evening. That guy has his first question. All right, so Dr. West, we're gonna start with you. 5 minutes opening remarks.
5 minutes. Oh no, these gonna be black minutes. I want to begin by just saying I'm blessed to be here. I salute each and every one of you for being here. I want to thank Sister Cass, Sister Ayo, and Brother James for those wonderful words. And I want to take a little time to say something about my brother Marvin X. I love this brother. He has enriched my life. He has empowered my sense of what it is to be a human being and what it is to be a freedom fighter. Mm. He's a love warrior, not just a polished professional. Sacrifice. Up, down, still consistent. And when he called me to be here, it was months ago.
Yes, sir.
And he'd been working on it. And I hear from him every night. Every night.
Everybody does.
In the midnight hour. And his midnight hour in Oakland is 3 o'clock in the morning for me on the East Coast. I'm still up reading. I said, there go Marvin X. And I called my brother Cliff. I said, yeah, I got it too, brother. But that's the kind of dedication, that's the kind of devotion, that's the kind of commitment, that's the kind of conviction he has.
Amen.
He has a love for those who I stone call everyday people. That's very rare these days among the older generation. Now the younger generation got a hunger and thirst. But the older generation becomes so obsessed with things and commodities and status and position, they become so well adjusted to injustice that they no longer have the focus on those James Cleveland called ordinary people. So that's why he is the African Socrates on the block. See, he's deeper than Socrates because Socrates never cried and never shed a tear. And anybody who's never cried and shed a tear never loved anybody. You can love wisdom, you can love abstract principles. I love Socrates' intellectual honesty, but it's not just intellectual honesty that's gonna allow you to empower others. You gotta learn how to cry.
That's right.
You gotta learn how to shed a tear. You're gonna learn how to empty yourself and donate yourself and give yourself. That's why he is one who on the block confused the tears with the tenacity of fighting. And that's why I'm here, my brother.
Yes, sir.
How many minutes have you? Because we're talking about the national situation, just very briefly, let's just be honest about it. We're living in an escalating neo-fascist country.
That's right.
There's a gangster in the White House. It's true. And see, I speak as a Christian, so when I say gangster, I'm talking about something inside of me, not just him. I was a gangster before I met Jesus, and now I'm just a redeemed son of a gangster for a Christian. Well, so this ain't name calling. This ain't finger pointing. I grew up with gangsters and thugs. Because I was with them. But we bounce back.
Yes.
But when you have a gangster in the White House with neo-fascist sensibilities, which means the rule of big money, Wall Street, 1% of the population owning more, 41% of the wealth, That's what's happening in Oakland. It is called gentrification, which is nothing but a power grab, a money grab, a wealth grab in the name of development. And then on the national level, there is a rule of big military. And nobody wants to talk about this in the bourgeois press.
Yes, sir.
You don't get it with reactionary Fox News or the milquetoast neoliberal MSNBC.
Well,
every $1.61 goes to the military industrial complex. Mm-hmm. So when they say they don't have money for our children, they don't have money for housing, you don't have money for health care, but anytime you go to war, you find money in a second. Overnight, trillions and trillions of it. So when you get to rule this, of big money, big military, then we grow up in a white supremacist civilization, and all you have to do is touch the button and mobilize significant slices of our vanilla brothers and sisters. And let us keep in mind, there's always vanilla brothers and sisters going against their reactionary cousins. John Brown ain't no joke.
That's right.
Man, Braden ain't no joke. Rabbi Abraham Dawson ain't no joke. There's been some white folk cutting against the grain. The problem is, it's a slice.
Yeah.
It's a slice. And then black folk, our movement, our freedom movement, has always been the leaven in the loaf.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
When we get weak, the whole loaf gets stale. Yeah.
Uh-oh.
It's true. America would not even be a democracy if instead of Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman, we had black versions of the Ku Klux Klan. What if every major black leader was a black version of the Ku Klux Klan? There'd be a civil war every generation. America would have gone fascist long time ago. But now, here comes Ida B. Wells Barnett. Here comes a Philip Randolph. Here comes Marcus Garvey. Here comes Benjamin Mays. Here comes Martin Luther King Jr. Here comes Malcolm X. These love warriors, they're not black versions of the KKK. Because after being terrorized for 400 years, they say, we're not going to terrorize me back. We want freedom for everybody. After being traumatized for 400 years, they say, we want to heal some folk. Listen to some Aretha. Listen to John Coltrane's Love Supreme. Listen to a little bit of Give Me One That's Love and the Need of Love. Read some James Baldwin's Love Soap essay. Turn to Toni Morrison's Be Loving. Ain't Mama the Most Loving Figure in the History of the American State, written by a genius named Lorraine Hansberry from the South Side of Chicago in her 20s. What is it about these heated people dishing out all these love warriors? I'm looking at one of them right here. Y'all got your own version of it, but I'm focusing on this brother today. What is it inside of him that will not allow him to hold his peace? We just keep throwing out. He's got to empty himself. He's got to donate himself. And that's what we got to pass on to the younger generation. And it cuts across ideology. You can be a Muslim like Malcolm X and be one of the greatest examples of what it is to tell the truth and to bear witness. You can be an agnostic like Audre Lorde, who's also a lesbian too. Oh Lord, some of them got challenges. Oh, but that's Audre. That's Audre. Or you can be a Buddhist like Bell Hooks. Love warrior to the core. When we talk about the national situation, we must have the lens through which we understand where this empire is at the moment.
Yes.
And it's experiencing spiritual breakdown, the eclipse of integrity, honesty, decency, and courage. And there's an imperial breakdown. Because the empire now, with 4,800 military units around the world, 900 in other parts of the nation, 128 countries, special operations going on, in U.S. government extensions military at work. It can no longer hold together. Things are falling apart. So the gangster in the White House is just a sign and a symptom.
Yes.
It's not a matter of just somehow getting him out of office and go back to business as usual. No, 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 not at all.
Tell it, Brother West.
We got some institutions and structures in place.
Yes.
We got some folk that got cowardly orientations. And all of the cowardly folk are not just vanilla folk.
That's right.
Tell it.
No, no, no. We got some cowardly black bourgeois folk.
Uh-oh. Over there.
We just can't wait to be highly successful at the top. And then want them to be the spectacle and the object of attention so that everybody else catching hell is supposed to live vicariously through them.
Wow. That's right.
And we're here to say that the measure of black freedom, the measure of black dignity is not to be measured by the unprecedented status of the black middle class and black professional class. You don't start there. You start in the prisons. You start on the corner. You start in the hood. You start on the, in the alley. That is the measure of what black freedom is. And I'm not anti-black bourgeois. I love my Jack and Jill brothers and sisters. But everybody knows that they were going to jail with the same level of intensity. As our precious black poor and black working class youth were going, we'd have different kind of black leadership.
Yes.
Our black churches would have a different kind of prison ministry.
Yes.
Our black politicians would have a different kind of focus.
Yes.
So we got to be concerned about what the Johnson brothers sang, which was lift every voice, not echo. We can't be an echo of what's happening.
That's right.
You can't be a blues woman, you can't be a jazz man unless you find your voice.
Yes. Yes.
Marvin X, Fresno, Oakland, married, M.A., Ph.D. in so many different forms. He found his voice and he was willing to act on it and yet still continue to grow. And I want to end on this note. The very fact that he's kind enough to have me here. It's true. He comes out of a black nationalist tradition.
That's right.
Isn't that true, brother?
Yes, sir.
A great black nationalist tradition. I've never been a black nationalist. I believe in black peoplehood. But any nation I've been suspicious of, because every nation for me is under the cross. And that cross stands for unarmed truth and unconditional love. And the condition of truth is to allow suffering to speak everybody's voice. So any nationalism, I've been highly suspicious of.
Okay.
But I learned from this brother. I learned from Mary Baraka.
Yeah.
I learned from Malcolm X. I learned from Minister Louis Farrakhan. All of those part of that nationalist tradition that says, I will come and be in dialogue to learn from you. I will come with my own revolutionary Christian orientation, trying to be true to myself, but recognizing that as we fuse forces in light of the acknowledgement of the different voices in the black freedom movement, this is more like a jazz orchestra than a military band. Military band got to be on the note, everybody on the note. No, we got folk on the side of it, under it. Some folk flat it out. Other folk hit the B flat and the sharp and want to hit the clear one. And that's when I, when this brother calls, I come running, and that's why I'm blessed to be here.
Okay, so no time. Father Marvin, opening remarks.
A few years ago, I was in San Francisco, and we put on the, I guess, 75th birthday celebration for Amiri Baraka. And it was video, and the video be crying. Tears of joy.
Yes, yes, yes.
But the brothers didn't appreciate that. They said, man, you supposed to be strong, man. Why you gonna be crying like that? Even though it was tears of joy. So So I'm saying that to say, I hope I don't get to crying up here tonight. But I'm so happy that we're here and that Brother Cornel showed up, and he showed up before. And the last time he showed up was 2001. At San Francisco State, we did the Kings and Queens of Black Consciousness. That's 20 years ago. So I told him today, I hope it ain't another 20 years. So I'll be 95. I'm serious. So I hope we'll come together again here in Oakland in the coming year, because Sister Ayodele mentioned the BAM Fest 20 for next year, Black Celebrating Black Arts Movement Business District Festival here in Oakland for August.
So me invited
Black you. August.
Yeah.
But let me say this now, I'm the teacher here. Student. Star student though. But the sister Ayo with her BAM CDC, she's already gotten from the California Arts Commission $100,000 for BAM 2020. Come on, man. But I would like for my input, suggestion, proposal for BAM 2020 that we have another conversation, maybe at the Paramount.
Yeah.
So more people can engage in the conversation for next year. I'm throwing that out. And I'm sure we can come up with additional funding to get to Paramount when we need to get to Paramount for consciousness.
Yes.
Yes. And I'm even down with doing it with Michael Morgan and his Oakland Symphony.
Right.
Hello. And I praise Michael Morgan, because you know when Michael Morgan said he wanted to do that Black Panther celebration concert, they told him, no, nigga, you ain't doing that. And Michael Morgan said, I'm going to do it or I'm out of here. And it was one of the best sold-out conferences in the history of the Paramount. So yeah, I want to do something with Michael Morgan, Oakland Symphony, Cornel West, and whoever else we can come up with, Angela, I don't care. And let's chop it up for BAM Fest 2020. On the local level, some of you know, I've been on the corner of 14th and Broadway for many, many years with my Academy of the Corner. Academy of the Corner, 14th and Broadway. I've gone through years of police harassment. They rode up on my corner three cars deep. We got a report that you were passing out the pornographic literature. Some of y'all might know what they're talking about. The mythology of pussy and dick. But I want you to know, out of the 30 books, that's the most controversial piece I've ever written. And perhaps the most healing, because it has literally healed. And I started out as a little 18-page pamphlet. But from that corner, you don't even believe this. People lined up to talk to me. Mothers came out of, one was working at the, what is that, Rite Aid. Right there, right? She went there and she came out and she said, Marvin, I just want you to, I'm gonna bring my daughter out here to talk to you. Cause I can't understand. You see my daughter, she's a pretty girl and she got two babies. And I can't understand why she go out and stay all night with a nigga and don't come back home with money for Pampers. Come on now. You know I'm raw. That's why they don't let me speak until I organize up my damn self. Let me say shit around here. I can talk on the East Coast sometimes 2 or 3 hours on KBIA, was that New York City? Shit, I, man, anyway. The brothers have read this little pamphlet. One brother, you know, I also have a cabin in the corner at the Ashby Flea Market. And on Lakeshore, as I said. But one young man from the Ashby Flea Market, he took the pamphlet home and he read it, and he came back, he said, thank you, Marvin, for writing this. He said, now I can go live my life. Because I thought I owned something that I didn't own.
Well.
And now I know I don't own it. It ain't mine to own. And so he said, now I can deal my life. Some other young brothers read it. One brother took several copies to give out to his friends, and he came back and reported to me a few weeks later, and he said, Marvin, my partners read it, and they went to court and got custody of each other.
Wow.
You understand? So, but even more than that, I want to just talk about how beautiful we are. Just from that corner, from what I've observed on that corner. Let me give you a big example. I put out a book and it was $100. $100 book. Okay? So that might sound like a lot of money to a non-academic person, but the academic people pay, what, $200 to $300 for a book, textbook,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Full of white supremacy lies.
Yeah.
Well, for the most part. So, some of my intellectual friends, they heard that I had this $100 book. They said, oh, man, I ain't paying Marvin X no $100 for no one of that shit to be writing. But, now listen to this. Show you how beautiful we are. Now, the common people, they said they wanted this book. They didn't have no $100. So what did they do? They put it on layaway. They put it on layaway. And they got it. And I didn't keep no record. I don't keep records. I give credit on the corner for my books, and I don't keep no record. And 99% of the people come back and pay me. 99%. This is how beautiful we are. I wrote a book called Pull Your Pants Up for the Black President. Pull Your Pants Up. And I went on the internet and I found an image of a brother with his pants off his behind, and I put it on the cover of the book.
Alright.
A brother came by, young brother. He said, look, dude, got up in my face. I had two killers. One was my brother standing right there with me. He didn't know who they were. OGs. And the young brother said, OG, See, my partners told me that it was an OG on the corner with a picture of my ass on his book. And he said, my ass is copyrighted. So you got to get my ass off your book. You understand? Because you know us youngsters, we don't like the OGs anyway. You know that. We want to smoke you, right? You know that, OG. So my brother, he's there. Like I say, he was a killer. And he listened. And the other brother, so the young brother went on across the street. And then, of course, the first thing my brother said, well, man, if that nigga said that to me, that's the first thing to do. I'm going to kill him straight out for even saying that to me. I didn't say nothing to him. So he went over to it was a coffee shop across the street at that time. And he had a little girlfriend over there. And I knew the girlfriend. I knew her mother. Good friend of mine, her mother. So anyway, I don't know what his girlfriend told him. But he came back across the street. He said, OG, you can keep my ass on your book. But let me tell you another story of how beautiful we are. I got two more black minutes. Look. So I'm selling my books. A young brother comes by. He doesn't have any money. So I give books away. That's why my part of reading my books is out of print right now. I give half of them away. But anyway, he doesn't have any money. So I said, well, here, man, here, take this. You can have this. So he walked about 3 feet and he stopped and he broke down. Mm. And I said, brother, what's the problem, bro? He said, man, ain't nobody ever gave me shit in my life.
Wow. Wow.
In his whole life.
Wow.
So, on the local level, I grew up in West Oakland, between Fresno and West Oakland. I grew up on 7th and Campbell.
All right.
You know, I grew up with Paul Cobb. He's sitting around here somewhere. Yeah, me and that Negro was childhood friends. And we still friends. I love him, man, because he, Cornel mentioned the Black Bourgeoisie. I say, you know, and Paul Cobb, he's a progressive. That was what I said. And I'll say he'll at least do half of what he said. Some won't do nothing. Right? And Paul will do at least half. You understand? And he helped. If you all have my Move-In newspaper, we put out about 11 issues last year, but Paul Cobb helped put out the first couple of issues and made it happen. Matter of fact, I think it was his suggestion that we even do the paper.
Yeah.
So as Kat said, and Greg gave her a wonderful introduction, and she's a powerful woman. Powerful woman. She ain't no dummy. She's a smart woman, powerful woman, organizer. I done seen her organize 10,000 people right there at Oscar Grant Plaza.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There.
Yeah, okay then. So she ain't nobody to play with. And we love her. And like Cornel said about Obama, we're going to protect her. And we don't too often have to check her. That ain't necessary, and she's a great actress, but My point is, in her activity, when she was just at the news conference, is that what the sister was in the back that you mentioned? Yeah, I saw the video. She was, Kat was right there. Now, on the local level again, we've been dealing with this police so long, this police problem. As is known, I went to Merritt College with Bobby Seale and Huey Newton. We studied together, we came into consciousness together, and they were in my, Bobby was in one of my plays about a young revolutionary black man trying to find himself. And he said I taught him and the other Black Panthers. But the point is, as for the police, we've been dealing with this problem a long, long time. And I'm trying to figure out how can we get to a solution to this problem. You understand? I mean, remember that song, How Long Has This Been Going On? How long has this been going on, and how much longer can it go on? You know, I mean, the Panthers tried, but they were faced overwhelming force of the state. It wasn't just the police, the National Guard, the Air Force, the United Nations, everybody came in on FBI, CIA, nigger snitches, agent provocateurs, all that. So the question still is, how can we secure our community? How can we, as a police, don't you see, whatever these, we don't want to say white people, but whatever these people want to do, they do. And they'll ask you, if they want to declare a sanctuary city, don't they declare it? They don't give a damn what the federal government say. State, what state sanctuary, they do it. Why do we say we got a community sanctuary and there ain't no police coming in here? Period. Nothing. That's it. That's all. We had enough of you. Get your ass up out of here. We don't need you. You act like a savage beast. You love to murder. And we had enough. And we got to say the same thing to some of our brothers. Oh, yeah. Cornel talks about selective suffering. Don't be talking about the police. And you ain't gonna talk about Dante. Yeah. Hmm. Let's talk about Dante too. We gotta clean up his act too. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. But now I've written about what they've done in Bush did it, Obama has done it, and I don't know, Trump probably still doing it, but they offered the insurgents in Iraq and Afghanistan and other places, they offered them three things if they would stop the violence, stop the insurgents. Three things. What did they offer them? If they would lay down their guns, I'll stop the violence, and pledge allegiance to the Constitution of their lands, they promised them three things: education, housing, and employment. That's what we need. That's all we need here.
That's right.
That's all we need. Housing, education,
and employment.
And employment. Because a lot of when we talk about domestic violence, a lot of that's caused by that tension in the home when Johnny go to jail and come back and then he want to get back with baby and baby with Dante. And it's a problem. I mean, we saw it in, Baby Boy, was that with Snoop Dogg? When Snoop Dogg came home, and he tried to get back with his woman, and with his woman with somebody else. So anyway, but that's part of the problem, that housing. And right now, right across the street here,
We got a 600-unit complex coming up.
Yep.
600-unit.
Yep.
Most part, market rate. Did we make a benefit package with them?
Yep.
Carmel developers, we worked out a benefit package. It's called a community benefit package that you can work out with developers when they come into your community and cause displacement and gentrification.
Right to say.
Whether it's housing or businesses or whatever.
Right to return.
Right to return and all that. For my part, and I said this on CAT, on KPFA, I said the same thing. They're doing, in South Africa, what they're doing, they're taking the occupying buildings like this.
Wow.
They're taking them over. And what the sisters are doing, the squatters in the houses, well, you know, we did that in the 60s, all in New York. I lived in apartment buildings in New York where the brothers and sisters just moved in, took over, turned on the water and the gas and the lights, and we lived there for years.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we may have to upgrade it and do it in these new developments. And you know, if we do it, the first thing you're going to say is what? Let's make a deal. Let's make a deal. And then we can talk, right? We can negotiate. Okay, we want 50%. Well, we'll give you 49%. Well, we want 47.5. On and on until we work out a deal. Not just for occupancy, but ownership. We want to own that building across the street. We'll own it. Sell it to us. We go to the Chinese and get some money. They own most of the shit around here anyway. And this is the last thing I say in my black minutes. See, be careful about this white supremacy. Because a lot of this white supremacy, and we'll get to that in the global part of the discussion, but a lot of this white supremacy ain't even white. Ain't even white.
Well,
it's global.
Yes.
It's everybody.
Yes.
They say 40% of the single housing in East Oakland is owned by Wall Street.
Wow.
Who's Wall Street? Everybody. Ain't just white people. I live right by up from Lake Merritt, and those apartments are mostly owned by what? Chinese, Asians. When I first moved there a few years ago, there used to be Mexican workers and handymen and all that. Oh, they gone. All the workers are Chinese now. They speak no English. So you know they just got here. So be careful about this white supremacy. I'll stop with that.
So, Bob and Marvin mentioned the party, the Black Panther Party, and I would be remiss not to acknowledge the first woman of the Black Panther Party, y'all. Matrika Lewis is in the house.
That's right.
One of my sheroes, also an artist, an amazing artist. And then Bobby was also talking about development, and I've been calling out this one piece of development as much as I can. It's on Kirkham in West Oakland. It's on public land. So West Oakland, we need to understand, we have 75% to 80% of the unhoused population of Oakland and West Oakland. And our electeds just approved 1,032-unit market-rate development on public land with 85 out of that 1,032 affordable.
Shame!
This is what is happening in the city. So I want to, we'll come back to housing and some other things on the national level, but I want to talk to you, Dr. West. We are barreling towards the 2020 presidential elections. And when you talk to most experts, a lot of experts, folks that watch this stuff, they say that the outcome of the 2020 elections is dependent on the black vote.
That's right.
And we've got voter suppression happening.
Yes.
We've got masses of our people that just are like, why vote, why bother? And then, we know that what the outcomes may have been on the ballot, in other words, what the outcome comes out the door as. Is the electoral arena on the national level still a critical place for black people to play on the path toward liberation?
I think you're absolutely right in terms of being a very crucial site. Very crucial site. Now, that doesn't mean that electoral politics somehow is the only place where the struggle takes place. Because in a society of predatory capitalism, plutocrats at the top will do anything to keep their power. If they were convinced that through voting you could have a fundamental change in revolution, they might make voting illegal across the board. That's the kind of gangsters at the top.
Or kill you at the polls.
Or exactly. Or the voter suppression and so forth. Now see, what we got to come to terms with the fact, and let's go back to 2016. Now 2016, you got Brother Bernie Sanders. Now Brother Bernie Sanders he's my dear brother. He's the second Jewish brother out of Brooklyn. He got a critique of capitalism that's unprecedented in terms of electoral politics. And he recognizes that if you don't hit poverty head on, you got to be an abolitionist about poverty.
Yes.
Just like you can be an abolitionist about prison, the way my dear sister Angela Davis is. But like Martin Luther King Jr., he said, if you don't come to terms with poverty, militarism, white supremacy, and materialism, you ain't gonna have a democracy after a while. Yeah. So here's when Brother Bernie comes along and got a critique of Wall Street, and everybody's laughing at him. We sit around the table, he's got 4% recognition and 2% support, and we sitting out saying, we're gonna win this thing. Everybody saying, you better get off the crack pipe. I'm saying, I come out of the tradition like Sun Ra.
Yes, sir.
We done tried everything possible. Let's try the impossible.
That's right. That's right.
That's like George Clinton on the mothership. We done tried everything. Let's try the mothership. Okay. Let's keep it funky. And we thank God for Clinton and Bootsy and others.
Yes.
Because even as they trying the impossible, they empowering us.
Yes.
That's right.
Sun Ra did the same thing, but his music.
Right. That's right.
Now, why is that important? Because ever since black folk got here, our primary problem is too much poverty, not enough self-love. So we got material problem of poverty, housing, health care, jobs. But then you got a spiritual problem.
Yes.
Do you love yourself?
That's right.
Do you respect yourself?
Yes.
Do you affirm others who look like you?
Yes.
Or do you love everybody but folk who look like you?
That's right.
That's a spiritual problem. And you can't just talk about the spiritual without talking about the material. You can't just talk about the material without talking about the spiritual. Now, what happened in 2016 is you get the most progressive politician in electoral politics that everybody's trashing, and the most progressive community in America, who are black people, didn't come out and support it.
Wow.
Here come Hillary.
Yeah.
War crimes in Libya?
That's right.
That's right.
That's right.
Drones in Afghanistan? Yeah.
That's right.
The war on... Well, the war on the criminalization of large numbers of black people.
Yes.
That's all under Sister Hillary.
Yeah. Yes.
That's right.
But she just tried herself out. The little black politicians come running.
Yes,
we got the little patriot systems in the churches and so forth. And everybody say, she's our candidate. And then she does Bernie in because she thought he's only at 4%. He gets 47%. He's unfair to him. If, in fact, in 2016, if we had massive black support for
Bernie,
there's no way a milquetoast neoliberal can beat a gangster like Trump. Trump got enthusiastic folk behind him and the press following him every second.
Yeah.
You gotta have somebody who has enthusiasm in their own way.
Yes.
Now over 55% of all young people over 30 voted for Brother Bernie.
Yeah.
Because young folk on fire. But it was the older folk who said, well, you know, we got to be very cautious about this day. We got to be safe. Proceed very slowly. And we end up with a new fashion.
Now here we go again, 2020. Here come Bonnie. Weak as pre-sweet and Kool-Aid. Backward looking, all he can do is talk about his relation to Obama. Got the Obama halo over his head. Oh, we appreciate it. Okay. You and Obama were tight. We appreciate that. And we should love Obama as a human being and as a black man, but we got to keep him accountable.
That's right.
When you love somebody, you correct and respect.
Yes.
You love somebody, you protect and check.
That's right.
And run around talking about you love somebody and never say a critical word. That ain't love.
That ain't love.
That's pandering to somebody. And if you focus on poor folks, you said, what's being done for them?
Yes.
What's being done in the new Jim Crow, the prisons? What's being done on the block in the educational, decrepit educational system? So the 2000, what do we get? Here come Bernie again. And Bernie's not perfect. He's just a brother. You know, every human being got faults and flaws and everything. And I'm not looking for him to break dance like MC Hammer. He's an older brother. He's anti-racist, but he doesn't have a powerful systemic kind of focus on white supremacy. His focus is on what? Wall Street. That's a good focus. If you got 1% of the population, you got 42% of the wealth. And Wall Street doesn't want you to have any access to the resources. When they were caught stealing, what happened to them? They not only got bailed out, and his brother Barack got to take credit. He had the meeting with them March 2009 and said, I stand between you and the pitchfork, but I want you to know I will protect you. And he did. Not one Wall Street executive went to jail.
That's right.
He let Jamal get caught with a crock bag and go to jail. But these gangsters at the top, not one of them go to jail.
Well,
and then they get free loans. $21 trillion out of the Federal Reserve, and our students can't even get free loans. They got to pay contact. So Bernie comes along and says, I'm going right to the source of predatory capitalism.
All right.
That takes a lot of courage. I don't care what color you are.
Oh,
you start messing with people's big money, big interest. They're going to start lying about you. They're going to start trashing you. Character assassination, and maybe even more. So we looked at him and said, you know what? We're going to go down fighting. We go down, all the different folk in the group. We got some Christians, we got some Muslims, we got some Buddhists, we got some agnostics, we got some atheists, all of them in the group. We're going to go down fight. So they start coming at us tooth and nail because we start telling some deep truths about predatory capitalism and its relation to the legacy of white supremacy. The reason why we here as African folk, we were commodities. That was a predatory capitalist project. 244 years. So don't let anybody talk to you about race, like race is something way up here. White supremacy is way up here.
That's right.
Grounded in the economy, in people's psyche, in the culture, in media, in churches, in mosques, in synagogues, in temples, in shakti, all of these institutions. So 2020 might be maybe the last chance, because the democracy is going under now. Oh, we got the gangsterization taking place across the board. Across the board, everybody for sale. Everything is for sale. The way you move, how do you sell yourself? When I talk to the young brothers and sisters, I try to love them to death, and they come up, Brother West, this is my brand. I say, I want to know what your cause is. Don't tell me what your cause is. Metaphor. Black people had brands on their bodies.
That's right.
Enslaved and commodified. Sold like cattle. Don't ever let anybody reduce you to just buying and selling. And obsessed with success only in terms of your capacity to buy and sell. Yes, we got to deal with markets, but markets can't dictate our humanity at the spiritual level. In 2020, we started off.
It was
very colorful in the Democratic Party, wasn't it?
Sister Kamala, Sister Kamala's a brilliant sister and so forth, but I got my critique. She's another neoliberal sister. You know, and I love it. And somebody talk about it as a racist or a sexist, I'm a protector.
That's right.
But I want to know, as especially for me as a Christian, I look through the lens, through the cross. What are you doing for the least of these?
Wow.
That's the measure.
Yeah.
How did you treat the prisoners?
Yeah.
How do you treat the poor children?
Yeah.
How do you treat the poor elderly?
Yeah.
What was your relation to the working movement?
Yeah.
What was your relation to the Mexicans on the border?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then when you project internationally, you see, here we got Africa. Right now, the imperial project, still driven by predatory capitalist interests, views Africa as the fundamental site because they have more resources than any other place in the world.
That's right.
So there's a fight now between the American Empire, the Chinese Empire, and the former European empires to get at the resources of Africa. And we got to be critical of some of the African leadership.
Yes.
They got bourgeoisies too at their worst.
Yeah.
That will sell their people down the river.
Yeah.
Just like we got members of the black bourgeoisie who will sell their souls for a mess of pottage.
Yeah.
And that's not hatred. I believe in Christian hatred. Which is you hate the sin and you still try to love the sinner.
Yeah.
You don't lose sight of the humanity, even of the gangster. Because there's a gangster in you.
Mm-hmm.
But you still hate the injustice.
Mm-hmm.
You hate the domination.
Mm-hmm.
You hate the exploitation.
Yeah.
And that's where you begin to both focus and fight. So when you look at the 20 election, what do you end up with? You end up with most of these pre-packaged, mediocre,
mm-hmm.
milquetoast
mm-hmm.
politicians
mm-hmm.
that will say almost anything to win.
Mm-hmm.
That will ask, when you ask them what are their convictions, they have to check to see what the polls say. And then give you what their convictions, which is to say, most of them are just thermometers. They just reflect what's out there.
Mm.
And we gotta look for thermostats.
Yeah.
Thermostats reshape the whole climate. They don't just reflect the climate.
Mm.
You see? And for me, Brother Bernie's the only one who has that capacity.
Okay.
Now, Sister Elizabeth Warren, who's been my colleague at Harvard for many, many years, and I, you know, I love her and respect her in many ways, but she's a Republican up until 1996.
Mm-hmm.
So we fight against Reagan. She's on the wrong side of the class war.
Well,
Reagan is doing in poor people, doing in black folk, pushing his white supremacist thing. She's there with him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I believe in conversion. Longevity of consistency and integrity, I'm a little suspicious of converts. All of a sudden they're on fire for POFO, and you get on the other side until y'all 46 years old. What happened? Holy Ghost hit? I believe in the Holy Ghost too, but the Lord, not for politicians. But she could be real. I could be wrong. I could be wrong. I like some of the things she said. Very much so. But those are the only two for me that are serious candidates to support. And yet, you can see that the media has been so down, especially on Fort Bernie. You can't get any coverage hardly at all.
That's right.
You get 15,000 people. You know,
this last time.
Absolutely. So, but we're going to see. You know, we're going to keep fighting. We're going to keep. But whatever happens, we're going to keep fighting.
Marvin, you started to lay out some of your solutions around police violence, and one of those was to create sanctuary hoods, where law enforcement is not welcome.
Right. I didn't learn how to act.
I've been doing this work for a hot minute.
Right.
And what I found is that our folks. Can't envision safety without connecting it to law enforcement. And you yourself brought up Dante, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I believe all violence is state violence, right? All violence is state violence. The state creates the conditions that create intercommunal violence. So that's my question to you is, within that context, let's say this is a no cop zone, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. What do we do with the Dantes?
Mm-hmm. Dante becomes just like what they did in the Middle East. They put him on security.
That's right.
They trained him to secure the community.
That's right.
That's what Dante did. It's like these devil white brothers. Some of them was what? Dantes? They got a new consciousness and they're securing the community. So that's what they can do. And I just want to add this in. See, this whole police thing, as we know, it's a class thing too. Because I've lived in Castro Valley. Matter of fact, I lived in San Diego where the police, well, I was teaching at UC San Diego, and police told my students, one student got stopped one day, and police told him, the student said, I'm going to take the badge number. He said, go ahead and take it. We stop all niggas in La Jolla.
Wow.
Nigga. Mm. You understand? At the same time, from living in, say, Castro Valley, my patron had houses there, and he wanted me to stay with his son for a time. And so I'm the only adult in the house, and they having the parties, the kids are partying, you know, and they drinking and smoking weed and all that, and you know, the white folks in Castro Valley ain't happy that this nigga live right across the street from Lake Chabot in the first place. So they call the police, and the police come to the door, and I don't really want to go to the door. I ain't happy about police in my life. But finally, the kid said, well, Marvin, the officer just wants to know if there is an adult in the house. So when I finally went to the door, I don't even know if I opened the door. I about to talk through the door. So they could see I was an adult. And they said, thank you, sir, and good night. You see how this, what you call it, selective protection. You know, and let me say one more example of that. The boys that I was babysitting, he got a car, and he drove without license and insurance and all this and speeding, through Castro Valley. And they knew who his daddy was. They knew his daddy was a rich nigga. Right? And so when they would stop the boy, what do you think they did? They didn't impound the car. They didn't take the boy to jail, juvenile hall. They called, sir, we have your son again. And would you come and get in? And that's it. So we know that these people that are acting like they can't be civil. And I was very happy when I was in Newark, when I was there for, when Baraka joined the ancestors, and then right after, I was there for Ross's inauguration as mayor. And even when Baraka deceased, there was a different relationship with that community and the police. Police, for example, they were all in his house. They blocked off the street. They gave protection to the family. And after he became mayor, the killing of black people stopped. Okay, by the police. But it was still going on, because I talked to the widow, Amina, and she said, yeah, Marvin, my son, he didn't stop the violence, the police killing us, but now we got the Crips and the Bloods in Newark. So we trying to deal with that. So my point is, you might be able to re-educate the police. You think that's possible? Perhaps send them through a re-education program. We want to be like the Chinese doing the Muslims in China now. Like, you know, put them in a concentration camp for a while. What? Re-educate them? That what they need?
No, I think for the police, you just got to make them accountable. They got to go to jail after a fair trial if they kill somebody.
Yes.
They got to break the cultural silence in the police departments to let people know that, in fact, maybe a slice of them will be accountable, because all of us are accountable for our actions outside. How come they're not accountable for theirs? You got to be consistent all the way through. Now, that kind of accountability will give you a quick education. You see what I mean? That's a quick education there. But it is true that in Newark, I was just with Brother Ross. We did a thing together at the Golden Dome. It was a beautiful gathering together.
Yes.
But it's a different tone, different atmosphere. Why? Because it's clear that there's a black mayor in Newark who not only has undergone similar kinds of experiences, but most importantly, he has a different vision.
Right.
And you see, skin pigmentation doesn't fully determine your vision.
That's right.
Right.
Skin pigmentation in America, if black, means you're going to catch some hell. That doesn't determine your vision. Clarence Thomas caught hell and decided something different than me. He's got a different perspective on things. And so in that sense, this accountability is crucial, and the consciousness that you talk about, awakening, is crucial. But I think in the end, though, you know, we don't hit this issue of poverty and wealth inequality and quality education and jobs and healthcare and housing.
Yes.
That's right.
And, you know, we're going off a cliff.
Yeah.
We're just going off a cliff.
I think I would just add, because I can, because I'm moderator.
That's right. Oh, absolutely.
Policing can't be fixed because it's not broken. Right. So policing was born out of the slave trade and crushed the beginnings of the labor movement. Their job then was to catch, kill, incarcerate, and maim black folks, and they're still doing their job. It's not like things were going well and then all of a sudden in 1952 something went horribly awry, and if we can just go back to there, it will work. No. You can't reform a system that is rooted, born of white supremacy, racism, hatred. You can't reform that. Our work has to be about creating alternative models, redefining what public safety is, and transmuting what we currently have into something that actually keeps us safe. I was saying this earlier. The city of Oakland gives the Oakland Police Department 42% of our general fund.
That's right.
Wow.
42% in Oakland. 42% of our general fund in the name of safety.
That's right.
In the name of safety. Yet we remain one of the top 10 deadliest cities per capita in the entire country. So if you're a data-driven person, that data don't bear out. What keeps us safe is mental health support. What keeps us safe is substance abuse prevention and treatment. What keeps us safe is economic opportunity. What keeps us safe is education. Those are the things that keep us safe. And at some point, we've got to get off the rat wheel. What not only Cat Brooks says, or Baba Marvin, or Dr. West says, and other folks, but mountains and mountains of data and actually models across the world say, create safe communities. And damn it, Oakland should be the vanguard for shifting how public safety works in this country, starting right now.
Let me say this.
That's my mayor.
In 1979, the police were killing a black man a month, right here in Oakland. I was teaching at the University of Nevada in Reno, teaching English to white kids.
That's all right, brother. That's all right.
ugly to white kids. Big old 6 foot redneck, don't know the difference between T-O and T-O-O and T-W-O. Think I'm gonna hate him? I didn't hate him. But every morning I used to read the Chronicle, San Francisco Chronicle, and the Oakland Tribune, and the whatever, Examiner, and all the LA Times, New York Times, all these papers, but mainly Oakland. And I would see they were killing a black man a month. And then finally, one day I saw this, the paper, the headline, another black man killed, and I threw the paper down. Then later that night, I flipped it to the back, and then this was my friend's brother, Melvin Black. If you remember, Melvin Black, 15 years old, shot by the police 15 times. I think John Burris started his career with Melvin Black. Okay, so we put on a rally at the Oakland Auditorium. Matter of fact, my brothers told me, Marvin, you need to come on back to Oakland and get down for the get down and leave them Ku Klux Klan, Mormons, and leave it all alone. Even though they were treating me good. I ain't gonna lie, they treated me good. I got two National Endowment for the Humanities Planning Grants. I had a full-time job as a planner, taught at the college, Upward Bound, community college. I was living real good. Elvis Cleaver came up here and stayed me. He said, you didn't pick all the lilies in the field. So ain't no lilies left for him. But anyway, my brother said, come on back, because we got a rally for Melvin Black. We put on the rally at the Oakland Auditorium. I called Mr. Farrakhan. Mr. Farrakhan came. We had Angela Davis, Eldridge, and Huey, and Eldridge was kind of didn't want to show at the same time on the same program. But anyway, 5,000 people showed up without incident. And then there was a call for the what? What did they just institute? The
Police Review Board.
Police Commission.
Police Review Board. No, Police Review Board. And I can't understand that we are how many years later after 1979, wow, and we're still talking about a Police Review Board. And now it's supposed to work. Does it have any teeth now, Cat?
No, sir.
Well, what is the nature of the current Police Review Board?
So the CPRB, the Community Police Review Board, is one body, right? But in 2016, Oakland voters overwhelmingly voted to create what was supposed to be, what you were told would be, an independent police commission. Now, I assume that when you heard independent, you assume, like I assume, that meant that it would be in the hands of the people. Right, that we would be doing what the Panther Party had to say forever, community control over the police. That is not what has happened. What has happened is that we have a police commission that has, it is controlled by the mayor, by the city administrator, and by the city council. And because of that, they've met so much resistance. They've met so much resistance that they haven't been able to get their jobs done. That's almost full-time positions that these people are doing volunteer. And they need to be paid. There should not be any mayoral appointees. The Libby Schaff gets three direct appointments to the committee. No vetting, no nothing. Just she said so. They haven't even refused to hire an independent investigator. Right? Like, there's just been so much obstruction, but we have a chance to shift this. So this is really important. Measure L, and a lot of us, like I made a lot of enemies over the fight around Measure LL because we refused to support it. Because we knew that this was what was going to happen and that it wasn't going to have any teeth in the mayor, and particularly that mayor. Let's remember in 2015, 7 black men were killed at the hands of the Oakland Police Department, and this mayor said, I don't see anything wrong with anything, including DeMaria Hall, who was asleep in his car at 2 o'clock in the morning. Wow. Now you're asking me to trust you, to trust her, to appoint people to a commission that's going to hold police accountable. So we were very vocally against it.
Make some enemies, that's okay. It's organizing, no permanent enemies, no permanent friends, they'll be all right. But we have, now we do have an opportunity in Oakland. Measure LL is coming back on the ballot. We're pushing for November. And you can go to the Anti-Police Terror Project page on the current campaigns and see what we're demanding and asking for. And actually, Councilmember Kaplan has been a big champion of this. And so we may actually have a commission with teeth, but that also means that you all have to come and engage in the commission. There are often two black people inside of that room.
Yeah.
Right? Two. And the organization that's been controlling it is led by white folks, and white folks can be allies, but they shouldn't be the table, and they certainly shouldn't say who sits at the table. These are the people that we need in the room on the police commission nights, and if you want to get more, we got to use the force policy to rewrite. Right, we're working on. We have this Measure LL stuff. We're trying to get an alternative to mental health response that doesn't lead with law enforcement. I appreciate that y'all love on me and say, "Yay, Cat, go, Cat." Cat's getting old, and I'm tired, and it can't be just me.
That's right.
It can't be just me. We need Oakland to get engaged in this, and the commission is the place to do it. Please come to those meetings. Please get engaged in the rewrite. As we do with my comments, and I say, walk the road of radical reform on the way to abolition. Mm-hmm. So can I ask, so it's 8, my sister Aya told me it's 8, but we started 15 minutes late.
It's not 8.
Okay.
Well, let's go to the global for a minute, and then we get to the Q&A.
No, you want to,
let's do some global.
It's 2 minutes late.
Okay, so well, we're gonna ask.
We start.
At 6.
Six?
We started late. We're just going to say we started late. Are you all good with us? Keep going.
Oh, yeah.
So, Dr. Wesson and then Marvin can follow up. There are uprisings happening in Lebanon, in Haiti, in Chile. There was the LGBTQ march that happened in Palestine. There's the organizing where this happening in Syria, just across the globe. Young people and organizers are rising up against oligarchies and violent governments. What relationship should organizers in this country be developing with those movements? And what does that mean for our path forward?
Now, I think this is a moment for very strong solidarity with people who are struggling across national boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
This is very important. And this is why, you know, when Du Bois raised those four questions, how does integrity face oppression? What does honesty do in the face of deception? What does decency do in the face of insult? What does courage do in the face of brute force? All four of those pillars. Integrity, honesty, decency, and courage. Those are the spiritual and moral raw stuff for any freedom movement. So when we see what's going on in Kashmir, we say, who is being subordinated? What kind of solidarity ought we to proceed? That's a moral and spiritual criteria. Same would be true in Chile. Same would be true in Tibet. This is true for Palestinian brothers and sisters under Israeli occupation. That's a complicated issue in the United States. Because our Jewish brothers and sisters have been mistreated for thousands of years. Demeaned and degraded and so forth, so they have an underdog mentality. But they're top dogs in that situation. It is hard for underdogs to shift the top dog. It's like when black folk here went to Liberia, what did we do? What did we do? We did exactly what the Europeans did to indigenous people. Go rename the country Liberia, rename the capital Monroe after James Monroe, a slaveholder of black people. Negroes, what's on your mind? We talk about freedom. Please, it's a human thing. But it has to be cast at that moral spiritual consistency across the board. Same is true in Iran right now. Same is true in Iraq right now. Same is true in India. Dalit peoples and so forth. And never forget what Du Bois said now. And this is a tough one. This is a very tough one. Because when Du Bois decided to leave the country, he said he didn't want to ever return, didn't want one molecule of his body to be buried in America, the American Empire. And he said, cheer up, the Negro in America can never win. You must go on the international stage to win. Because the white supremacy and the predatory capitalism are so overwhelming that any black person who falls in love with black people better be ready to get crucified. And there's very few folk who are willing to be crucified for black people. And when you see somebody who's willing to be crucified for black people, you ought to check them out. I'm not saying you accept everything they do, but they got something on the inside. Now, I want to end on this note, though, and that is our artists and our musicians. And this is especially in regard to our dear brother Marvin X, who has been a artist as well as a freedom fighter, an artist as well as a teacher. We talk about this by flipping it all in my class. What does it mean to actually have a role that is so enriching to people's lives that they will pay $100 to see you? I paid $100 to see Luther Vandross. I would have paid the Negro $200. That's right. I played Sly Stone $50 in 1971. I was broke as the Ten Commandments. I would have paid $100 for that. Because he's bringing something that is so tied to my nourishment. Yes. That we have to have activists, intellectuals, who are as dispensable and so crucial to people as the best of our musicians. Yes. People would line up for Soul Train for blocks just to hear him blow, because what he came out of his horn was so informing your soul. Yes. You needed it. Yes. You stayed for a James Brown concert twice. What? Twice. And he'd go for 3.5 hours, and he would say then at every concert, I'm an extension of you, you're an extension of me, I don't exist without you. I come to serve you. Did anybody come here to hear a song we didn't play? You didn't hear, you didn't play Soul Power, you said, hit it, Bootsy. Yeah, you came to serve. We forgot that song. We spent too much time on Payback. But orientation has to be one of service, but it has to be now cast on the global scale.
Yes.
Solidarity. And it doesn't mean you lose sight of your specificity. It doesn't, solidarity doesn't mean you are somehow just enveloped in some abstract universal.
Strategic unity.
Strategic unity is grounded in your particularity. You go in as who you are in light of what has been shaped, and then you say, this is what I have to offer, and I know y'all's got something to offer us, because we need some solidarity from outside the United States as well.
Yes.
Deep solidarity. Yes. So on this international issue, it's a crucial one.
Yes. Well, let me give you an example of solidarity.
Yes.
During the Vietnam War, I refused to go. Like Muhammad Ali said, the economy didn't call me no nigga. So I first went to Canada, and then I found out racism was as Canadian as hockey.
I never heard that before.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's what they say. And I came back to America, but eventually, make a long story short, I left again after I was convicted for draft evasion. After going to Canada, and I came back, and then I got caught, and then I was brought to trial, and before sentencing, I left the second time.
Go, Marvin.
And went to Mexico City. And in Mexico City, one day I found myself on an aisle, on an island in the middle of the street, a little grassy island. And on that island, this is 1970. So I'm a young man, and I'm on this island with these other young brothers from throughout Latin America. We all on that island, from Cuba and Dominican Republic and Honduras and Venezuela, and Colombia, all there had been sent out of their country, some, you know, by force. Like Dominican Republic, they sent a bunch of young brothers out of there during that time. So we were all in Mexico City, which is still giving refuge to political refugees. Just like they did with Bolivia the other day, that the president come there. So we were there, and I've been thinking about it recently, how, what a sight that was, and the only problem I had was that I'm looking at my black brothers from Cuba, Colombia, Venezuela, and everywhere, and I can't speak Spanish. I couldn't speak Spanish. All I could say was para negro. Para negro. You know. But we understood. And then I made a critical mistake. And my contact in Mexico City was the most famous revolutionary black woman artist, Elizabeth Catlett Mora. Now Google her if you don't know who she is. Elizabeth Catlett Mora was my contact when I got there. So after a few weeks, I was tired of hearing Spanish. I wanted to hear some English. And I made a contact with some brothers from Belize. And they gave me a glowing picture of Belize. Told me I could live on this island for $7 a month, U.S. in a hut. They said hut, they said house. But when I told Betty Catlett Mora, she said, "No, no, 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 Marvin. It was still British Honduras. It wasn't Belize." She said, "Do not go there. They not, they're still under colonialism. They ain't even neo-colonialism. It's raw colonialism." And of course, I'm hard-headed like a Negro. So I go to Belize, and I have my pregnant wife here, the mother of my grandson right there. That spoke, and so we go to Belize, and it was talking about Rocky Road ice cream. That was the rockiest road I ever rode all my life. So I get there, I meet my revolutionary brothers who had I made contact with, but I didn't come in the way they told me to go because the Negro's hard headed. Okay, so I'm in there, and these brothers are on trial for sedition. Which sedition is anything the government say it is. Yes. That's what sedition is. Anything they say. And they said, the brothers had said something like, the politics or something like games old people play. They got them on trial for sedition. So I'm hooked up with them. Matter of fact, I'm foreign editor for Muhammad Speaks. So I'm writing back about what's going on at the trial. So you know I was under surveillance, right? Yeah. You know I'm under surveillance. So I go out, we moved out to this so-called island in the sun for $7 US a month. A little hut. And you know, but we survive, you know, with no money, damn near. Like the other people, and people want to know, Negro, why did you leave the richest country in the world to come here broke, and we broke? That's what they want to know. How could you do that? But they wanted me to teach black power out on this island, five hours through the jungle in a boat. 5 hours. So they came to our little hut to be taught. I didn't beg to teach them, they came to me. So, but anyway, one night drunk man came by and he sang a song. They coming to get you in the morning. You've been down here teaching that black power. And they coming to get you in the morning. And me and my wife said, I wish that I didn't get away with my dough. That old drunk nigga get away with my dough. Well, I got on a boat the next morning. That's a long story, I'll cut it short, but the next thing I know, I was taken before the Minister of Home Affairs, and he read my deportation order, and he said, your presence is not beneficial to the welfare of the British colony of Honduras. Therefore, you will be leaving for Miami by way of the airport at 4 p.m. Meanwhile, you're under arrest. So they took me to the police station. They didn't put me in jail. They didn't handcuff me. They sat me down in the lobby. And suddenly, all these black police officers surrounded me. And they had me in a circle. And then they said, brother, teach us about black power. So this is difficult, police.
Yeah, definitely.
Power in your story.
Yes.
So we are going to open up to a few questions because, as you see, my brothers are beautifully, beautifully verbose. So if you've got a question, how do I want to do this?
Walk right up there.
Yeah, go on out there and talk. Anywhere you want to do it.
I got it
first. Hold on, I'm going to go over here first.
I moved to San Francisco in 1960.
Will Usery. Come on now. Will Usery, 90 years old.
There were at least 10 service stations in San Francisco where you could stop and get gasoline. Today, there's not a single gasoline station in San Francisco.
Black hole.
I would even have trouble in San Francisco today finding a place to send my laundry to get a shirt washed.
Wow.
Yes, sir. Oakland is about to be shot in the 2020 census on the same decline in African American population that we have experienced in San Francisco. Conversations like this are important for us to have. And Marvin, you would be congratulated for bringing Dr. West here, so that he could share with us the powerful intellect that he has and provides to all of us.
Yes.
And really, that's marvelous that you have a relationship where you can bring that to this town for us.
Yes, sir.
But I have a concern about these kinds of meetings in these kinds of times. And it's important when we assemble as much intellect as we have in this room, that we understand how to examine the fabric of our community relative to the struggle that we're having with racism in this country. It is a misuse of intellectual power that we might have if we're not examining the fabric of our community relative to what we need to add to it, improve what we've got, and know how to identify a set of action that we can undertake to improve our condition. I don't know how many of you have heard the word artificial intelligence. The two or three people at the top of that industry are saying it is going to have the impact on human society bigger than our use of electricity. Now you think on that for a while. Salespeople in stores, grocery stores, is the next round of folks at truck drivers who are going to lose their jobs because of what your Comcast monitor does for you. Where you don't put the numbers on going to a channel, you talk to it. Now what I'm getting to is very, very simple. I would hope that the next time we have this kind of intellect in the room, we are able to have a conversation about what is the nature of the instruments that we need to create to deal with the problem institutionally that we're confronting. And it doesn't come from war stories of the past that we hear from. I've got them too. I can tell you about in 1960 when Dr. Carlton Goodland was too sick, and some of his patients were too sick, and he designated me as his surrogate to go to two conferences in Africa, and I got put on the commissions of the five liberation movements in Africa.
That's right. That was
1969. So I've been through this thing, and I understand the importance of our examining institutional structure, and we use these kinds of meetings to get a better understanding of what we got to do right now to deal with the economic inequity.
Yeah.
A whole bunch of other stuff going on.
Yeah.
So I don't want to be critical of anything that went down on making this meeting happen. I praise you for that. But I also say it is a mistake for us to repeat this kind of meeting.
That's right.
If we've got this kind of the ability to put this kind of intellectual power together. That's what I wanted to say.
Take a couple more questions. I won't really interrupt my elder and my Bible, but I will let them in. Questions.
Hi, my name is Kimberly Graves, and I would like to know, what do you guys think is the best way to create entrepreneurs and teach our people how they should have their own businesses and how to be self-supported? Like we had before when they burned out Black Wall Street.
Let me, I'd like to take that first.
Sure.
As I said, I grew up in West Oakland on 7th Street, so I grew up in a Black cultural economic district. I know what it is, what it looks like. Been to Harlem, Chicago, Philly, South, other places, Houston. But as far as Oakland, first of all, the Black Arts Movement Business and Cultural District is part of the city of Oakland's 25 to 50 year downtown plan. Of course, we only heard of it when they were close to the final report, as we usually do. But we forced our way to get the Black Arts Movement Business District included in the downtown Oakland plan for the next 25 to 50 years. Paul Cobb, Io, Brother Midway, Conway Jones, Anika Barber, Eric Arnold, who else? Others. Anyway, so the problem is this. As I said about this building across the street, Carmel, we were able to win benefit packages for the retail space, right? Per square foot. Below market rate.
Okay,
we got that. I don't know how many, what percentage of housing did we get?
Carmel did affordable housing at 20%.
20%. 20%.
affordable, if we don't market. Bard is building Lake Merritt development, and they're going to give 50%. They're going to do the same thing at Ashby Bard. So you better, you know, if you don't know what's going on, you better try to find out. And you better start going to the planning committee meetings and city council meetings. Because they're planning for the next 25 to 50 years. Okay, so now as far as entrepreneurs, I've been calling for street vendors in Oakland since the first black mayor administration, Lionel Wilson. You know how long that's been? Meanwhile, we have street vendors on the streets of San Francisco, on the streets of Berkeley. Why not on the streets of Oakland? What is the problem? But fast forward, Jerry Brown just passed before he left office, what? SB 946 regarding street vending throughout California. As a result of the mostly 30,000 Latino street vendors in LA who got organized. And he passed the law, SB 946, you need to read it. The police can't give you high fines. They can't confiscate your goods. They can't ask for your immigration papers, et cetera, et cetera. So there's no reason we who are vendors, I say entrepreneurs, because you can, hey, don't you see these Latino brothers start with a taco truck, the next thing you know they got a restaurant? Yeah. Give me a break. They're vending and then they got a restaurant. They're vending, they got a Chicano grocery store, market. So you can start small, because if you start as a street vendor, because you might not be able to pay even this square footage retail rent for that retail space across the street there. So I'm just, I'm organizing, I want to organize a street vendors association. Because you all know what Barbecue Becky did at Lake Merritt. She brought out all the vendors. And so that was a racist thing that turned into a good thing. Because that made us take power. We took power. The brother, we got so much power, we sparking in the middle of the street. And that don't mean that you can't continue parking in the middle of the street, because if you go to Chinatown, you can double park all day long and no traffic, get no ticket.
That's true. I just want to say too that what my brother's talking about in terms of the organization of the vendors and entrepreneurs is a fascinating article in the movement.
Okay.
The recent issue. They got a whole analysis of Los Angeles as it relates to Oakland.
Yeah. Everybody should have it. Everybody have the paper?
Access to credit, access to capital. Oh, you got it.
The paper, they?
I'm talking about your special edition.
Yes. Well, we got copies for you. Yeah, don't leave without it.
Especially to get it to our dear sister here with that one article.
Okay.
But the crucial thing is, and I want to speak to my dear brother who was so eloquent, but I think it is connected. I mean, you're absolutely right in terms of how we have to make sure that we're intervening in the present, building on the best of the past and so forth. But access to credit and access to capital and resources, so that a lot of times these folk have families that are willing to work a lot of hours. You can almost exploit fellow member families to generate wealth, so that you then have a record to go back to that bank and get more capital back and forth. Now that presupposes what? That presupposes we got to trust one another. We got to be able to rely on one another. That's that spiritual thing comes back again. You see, so when we talk about collective pressure, organizing, mobilizing, we won't get anywhere if we don't have our spirits intact.
That's right. That's the problem.
And we learn both from the past and the present as to how we gonna fight. If we were dealing with folk who gonna sell out, cave in, and give up, then you're not gonna have no entrepreneurial class.
That's right.
You gotta have folk who wanting to fight in it.
Yes.
Folk who are humble enough to learn from one another,
yes,
but tenacious enough to take a stand, yes, and fight.
Yes.
So the two questions are wonderful questions in terms of how they overlap, even given these new breakthroughs in technological innovation,
yes,
and ways in which they can be used to subordinate and exploit people in the future. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to take one more brother and one more sister. I have to go.
Yes, I'm over here, Kat.
Yeah, I'm going to go with myself first.
Okay, then.
Thank you. Thank you, Marvin.
Yeah.
You have 20 books that are out of print. How can we support you to get those books printed again?
Yes.
My patron said before he passed, Marvin, stop giving them away. So if I try to give it to you, don't accept it without paying for it. That might help. But seriously, Dennis is my printer. He's printed several of my books. And we were both mentored by a black master printer in San Francisco who's passed on, that you should just know his name, Bob Watson. But he was a master printer, and he had to tell me when I brought him my autobiography, he said, well, Marvin, let me think about this book, because you ain't the only artist. I'm an artist too, as a printer. He said, let me think about the paper. Let me think about the ink, what color I want, and on and on. So he was a master printer. And he gave us some standards, and we're implementing them because we're standing on his shoulders, and we're trying to pass this knowledge on to the young brother Adam. Where's Adam Turner at? Because Adam designed the paper, he designed a couple of my last books, and I just want to give him a hand, Adam Turner. Photographer also, and we trying to make him understand he's standing on some people's shoulders.
Yes.
You know, and you don't have to worry, you don't have to get scared, and you don't have to tremble. So, Dennis, I have a problem. If I printed 1,000 copies of my book in China, it would cost about $2,000, maybe with the tariff, Trump tariff, add 25% tariff, whatever that is. Here, 1,000 books gonna cost about
$7,000.
Wow. That's what it is, about $7,000. When the dentist printed or the other brothers at these copy places, it's gonna cost about $7,000 for 1,000. Or they can do what you call print on demand, they can print 100. Right, that would be what, $700 for 100. So, y'all can send donations, like, what is it, Patreon? You can send me $50 a month or $5 a month or something so we could get these books out. And that would help. Any donation, any amount, we got nonprofit. Did it hit my fiscal agent? She will get her fee though. But you can help by donating. And I want to say, I didn't finish saying when I was talking about black people are so beautiful. I wanted to tell you that I have angels. Y'all don't believe in angels. Y'all don't believe in them.
Take it back.
I don't know about that. I don't know about that.
Take it back.
But I have angels.
Oh, yeah.
And Cornel met one of them tonight. I don't know if you remember, but the yes, brother's here.
Yes, I did.
You remember?
I know exactly
He met one of the angels.
He
said, no, it ain't.
Oh, yeah.
He, the brother that supports my work, and he comes by and drops a 20 or 10 or 30 in the jar. And then I used to have an angel. He would come to 14th and Broadway. Mm. And you would think he was the bum of the week. But he was a special forces brother. He'd been in special forces. But he appreciated what I was doing. So he would come and sit at my table right there, 14th and Broadway. And any black woman, I say woman now, discrimination, sexual discrimination, I call it. He would, if she didn't have no money, he'd pay for her book. And he did this on, he said, he ain't paying for no nigga book. But he paid for her book. But now, recently, on Lakeshore, I've had a sister that would come out there, and she just sit. And anybody that wanted a book that didn't have no money, she just reached right there and paid me and give them the book. Wow. Now, these ain't angels, what's an angel?
That's right.
What's an angel?
That's right.
So we got people that will support me, and I just finally gonna have one black minute.
That's not five
minutes. Finally, to this event. This wasn't no Marvin X event, I just chief organizer. But this was a community event.
Yeah.
Supported by community. Some people donated 100, some people 250, 500, 1,000, 2,000. And we thank the Berkeley Co-op Bank. They donated about 4,000.
Yeah.
That's right. That's right. To make this event happen. Because it costs a lot of money. I got to pay the security. You see, we got more security than they got at the White House, right? Yeah. And I thank the brothers from the FOI to Brother Shay and
Community Ready Corps.
And there's some other, I don't know how many is here.
Shay, Turhan.
Yes. Thank you, brothers. But we need to feel safe. That's the number one thing, to feel safe when we come together.
Yes.
And then we can talk freely. And I don't know whatever Will, you know, you can plan the agenda. Will's a planner. He ran the EOC in San Francisco. Will been a radical for, he's 90 some years old. I was here, I think it's Geoffrey's on his 90th birthday. And he was dancing. He was dancing with Maxine. So help us get whatever you can. That's what people did to get us here. Don't you see how we got it? We're here. And it was a community effort. Give what you can. Do what you can. Some people didn't donate money. Dolores Nochi Cooper is here. Come on. She's the organizer of Berkeley Juneteenth. What do you say? 31 years? Been doing it 31 years. But she said, I'll donate my time, Marvin. I'll give you my time free.
Wow.
And another sister, Lanice Jones here. Lanice here.
She's not here.
Well, I talked to her this morning. I thought she was coming, her and her sister. But anyway, Lanice is a publicist. She said, Marvin, I'll do this for you for free. I don't want no money.
Yeah.
So this is how we got here. So be thankful. Geoffrey got alcohol, the food back there. I guess if there's any left. I know y'all about ready for a drink, ain't
you? Ronald, we got one more question.
Okay.
We got one more question. This is the last question of the night.
Dr. West, I was worried about the civil rights bill that they passed yesterday. 223 votes from the House, 192 from the Republicans that said no, and then 26 abstained. That were, and this was a nonpartisan. It was not bipartisan. It was vote based on sides. I was wondering, what does that mean for us as black people when, for the first time in years, they voted down party lines for the Civil Rights Voting Act? Is that a message that's coming to us as a people?
And I hope we do have time for one or two more questions.
So, not everybody heard the question, Dr. West. So the sister was talking about the vote that happened yesterday.
Can I
ask you
a question?
No, sir. We have this woman, this sister has asked a question. She's the last question of the night, and then we're going to close up. The sister was talking about the Voting Rights Act vote that happened yesterday, the Civil Rights vote that happened yesterday, and the vote went straight down party lines for or against. And so she's asked Dr. West, is that a message to us as black people? And if folks, I know we've been here for a minute, if folks could sort of just hold it down in the back, it's making it hard for people to hear. If people stop talking in the back, it's making it hard for people to hear. Thank you.
And I am willing to stay for other questions if people do feel something in their spirit that's overflowing, you know what I mean? Because it's up to all of us together. I'm here to follow instructions.
Can we go on for some more?
Definitely, absolutely. Yeah. But the thing is that your question is a crucial one in terms of just how polarized we are in Congress as well as in society as a whole. But I think even more important is what's happened in the Supreme Court in the Bayard Allen case. They heard it on November 13th. There was a long struggle all this summer to try to stop that from going, because that was going to strip the 1866 Civil Rights Act that said that there could be a variety of factors, including race, that can be invoked to show that discrimination has taken place. Mm-hmm. Now, what they're pushing for in the Comcast case, and this is what Byron Allen has been pushing, Sister Yvette and Brother Tone and others of Adolph's have been accenting this in terms of what happens when you can show only race as the sole criteria, sole factor, sole element. And that's very, very difficult to show. Which means then that discrimination is going to increase, it's going to expand, because it's going to be harder for the courts to be able to intervene and say, this is racist. Because if there's any other factors other than race, then there supposedly is no longer racist in that narrow sense. And we were fighting to try to make sure the Supreme Court didn't even see the case, trying to convince Comcast not to bring it. And it was a complicated situation with Comcast. Why? Because Comcast is supposed to be liberal. This is MSNBC. And the telecommunications industry disproportionately contributes to black civil rights organizations. So they more and more felt as if they had a noose around their neck. And we had to bring pressure to bear on the NAACP. NAACP is historic, magnificent, but they're deeply tied to telecommunications in terms of money flow. Urban League was even worse. It wasn't for Brother Lawson down in L.A. who submitted an independent brief different than the National Urban League. Mm-hmm. We all love Brother Mark Murray. Y'all been at it for a long time. But David Cohen is on his head of his board. David Cohen's second man in place in Comcast, even though he just left 3 days ago. So things getting complicated. You see what I mean? So that what happened was, it was very difficult for the black civil rights folk to come forward early on. We put the pressure on my dear brother Charlotte, because he also got tied to telecommunications.
That's right.
You know, all you got to do is go to these conventions and you see who the sponsors are. Wow. You see Comcast, Wells Fargo, and so forth. Well, if Wells Fargo is accused of racism and they're contributing 1/4 of your budget, you in a situation. And for me, it's just a matter of being honest. All you gotta do is tell the people, be honest. We are strongly anti-racist. We just got some folk who got a noose around our neck, so we can only do certain things. Some of us can come forward and be courageous, others gonna take the money and pull back. Just tell the people, all of us in dilemmas, all of us in institutions that we work, where we know we got stuff coming at us. But you gotta be honest about that. Well, thank God that there was a number of folk who began to come forward that created such an overwhelming momentum, even the Black Congressional Caucus began. And the Black Congressional Caucuses have not been on the cutting edge. The most serious self-sacrificial folks for self-judgment. We glad they're there, but you don't hold your breath. Because they got their interests. And they got their funders for their next election. We understand we all caught in that way, you see.
but we have to be candid. And so I would say the polarization you talk about, very real in the legislative branch. But it's these vicious courts we got to keep our eyes on. Because they are the ultimate adjudicators of the interpretation of the law. And the gangsters already chosen 157 of them for life. And two of them at the highest level, Supreme Court, and maybe three. Maybe three, if Sister Ruth gets shit. What's her last name? Yeah, I'm praying for her everything. It'll wobble, you know. I know we got at least two more questions.
I'm going to do a brother and I'm going to do a sister.
Exactly.
That'll be two less people mad at me.
That's
and you two have to be disciplined in your answering of the questions.
Yes, indeed.
Question, right?
Okay. Yeah, I'm Steve Williams, and I know Marvin, excuse me, for quite some time. We have history and Dr. Daly. And you spoke briefly about police assassination, execution, and murder of black citizens. And I wanted to know, what do you think about the dialogue that certain representatives of black communities are saying that the police should be retrained and re-indoctrinated as to how to approach and not kill our people when they don't have to be trained how not to kill white people? So do you think that training would be a solution to the homicide behavior that they have on our people?
You want to say something?
Well, Cat said you can't heal something that's what?
I said you can't fix something that's not broken.
And they've been slave catchers for about 400 years.
And you can't reform something that's rooted in white supremacy, capitalism, and hatred.
So I say we need what I said about the sanctuary hood. Police, no go. Don't they have areas like that all over France, different places?
All over the globe.
All over the globe. Police, no go. Used to be based in Richmond like that.
Yeah.
He's Oakland too.
Dr. West, did you want to say something?
No, I think the important thing to keep in mind is that the racism and white supremacy when it comes to police mistreating our precious young people is very real. But there are a lot of white brothers and sisters getting killed by the police too.
So what role does the family play?
Plays a crucial role in terms of trying to bond, create some kind of connections, some kind of shaping of the soul and character of young folk in such a way that they can walk with dignity with their heads up and believe in themselves and have confidence in themselves. But that's not just for the family. This is true if our churches were doing what they're supposed to do. This is what the boss to do. This is what the temple is supposed to do. It's supposed to take them and shape them in such a way that they can walk through space and time with a self-respect. But it's been breaking down. Been breaking down. The Shiloh Baptist Church in Sacramento, California, we had a pastor. We didn't have no CEO.
Dr. West, can I ask a point of clarification? Dr. West?
We had a love man. We didn't have a... You see what I mean? So but this question is, the racism is still deep. But I don't want anybody to have the impression that the police are not also killing some of the white folks.
That's right.
The Washington Post has an annual report that I would just check out. Washington Report, annual report on police murder. And they keep track of all the fellow citizens who have been shot. And black folk, the highest percentage, but at the same time, there's a whole lot of white folk getting shot too.
Dr. West, can I get a point of clarification?
Yes.
You are suggesting that if we raise our children better, that police would kill less of them. That's not what you
No.
Said.
No.
I just don't want to be sure.
I'm saying if we raise our children better, our freedom movement would be more healthy.
Got it. Got it.
That's the key.
Got it.
We want to help the freedom movement.
Got it. Okay, this is the last question. All right, sister.
Last. We all right, though. I'm all right. I'm all right, too.
I'm so honored to have the last question, and I wanted to cite that the brilliance occurred in this room, the intellectual capital, as Will so articulated his particular question has been on my mind for a long, it'll be on my mind all night, thinking about what he said in terms of AI. But having said that, I wanted to honor Cat Brooks again and tell everyone, if you get a chance, when you wake up early in the morning, 7 o'clock, KPFA, FM, is something that keeps your mind alive to continue to work to change.
Denise, please listen to Cat Brooks every morning. Come on. KPFA.
What 7 o'clock in the morning. And that's a prayer for Craig. I like your traditions, don't you? But anyway, I had two baby questions. I'm going to do one. And that's because I'm in the church. I'm active in the church. I'm very concerned about what I consider to be the silence of the church. And even in terms of what has occurred here, I think this is a great venue. I feel church is all up in here. But I am very disturbed by what Marvin, had the challenges he faced to get that here. So I wanted to hear what you're seeing about the church and how it's trying to move or becoming more active. What examples? We also have to keep hope alive. But I'm concerned. I'm in a church that I'm concerned about. So I wanted to raise that. And then I'll give one quick example. I didn't know what was happening in my church, which I won't go into that too much, but we are currently the people that are managing us. I don't want to say managing, bring the Holy Spirit are from the continent of Africa. So I was so excited, I was excited about that because I love Africa, been to Nigeria. My people are go back and forth to Ghana. So I'm like, that's my question. Real quick, is that when I was listening to Wode Moyi on YouTube, and I don't know how many of you listen to Wode Moyi, he's from Ghana, he's having issues visiting, he's visited more than 20 countries and he does analysis, but when he went to these 20 countries, we told him, you should go and check out Zambia. The reason why I said that, because my spiritual leadership from Zambia, he said when he stepped in on the soccer, he was shocked because he thought he was in China. So that's an aside. All I'm saying is, in terms of the church, worldwide, globally, what are you seeing? Are we moving the agenda, or are we just in bed with the enemy? Thank you.
Thank you.
Amen. You want to say a little
question? I'll say this. I wrote a book. One of my books is called Beyond Religion, Towards Spirituality. And as I look around the world, these religions, no matter what religion, Christianity, Islam, Yoruba, whatever, some of these practices, rituals are primitive, archaic, retrograde, such as female circumcision. I'm against. I don't see why a woman should be deprived of pleasure. I can't get that. I didn't know men did that. But something got to be done about it. It ain't right to me. Abortion, on one level, I say that's a woman's business. I say a woman's business. Because it's her body, it ain't yours. Yeah. You don't get pregnant, Negro. Yeah. Some of you trying. Yeah, you don't have no cycle, although some girls say you act like you do. But religions are in trouble for abuse. Yeah, that's right. Children, boys, girls, women. I don't care what religion. examine them. So the question is, where are we going from here into the future? Are we going to carry the same primitive mythology and ritual practice going forward? Thank God for me too. This is going to help a little, I don't know how much. It's going to help a little, back men up. You can't have everything you want to have when you want to have it. Because it ain't yours to have. It's that simple, ain't yours to have. And I don't know, I tend to think men are predators. But you got to back your ass up from being a predator. And the sad thing about it, I asked a woman in the military, because it's what, 30% people are raped in the military. Men and women. Did y'all know that?
Yeah.
Men and women. Check the stats. But I asked one sister from here who said she was raped in the military. I said, well, you had a gun. Why, you couldn't do something to your aggressor. She said, we're not taught to do that. Not taught to do that. But what I'm trying to say is, we, sometimes I think we need to just, some of these holy books need to be closed. Because they ain't follow nothing Jesus said. Nothing Muhammad said. Nothing Buddha said. Nothing nobody said. You ain't following nothing. You ain't following what Malcolm said, Elijah Muhammad. Well, Martin Luther King.
Fannie Lou Hamer.
What are you doing? And you talk about saving the climate. Didn't somebody say the earth gonna be here? Where your ass gonna be?
Amen.
Maybe you need to be washed away. Maybe the sea need to rise on your ass. You ain't doing nothing. You ain't doing shit. Nothing but breathing. Talk about your bacon. Go eat a cow.
I can just hear by saying a word about Jesus. Come on, ladies.
Hey, hey. Preacher,
what black folks have been able to do in the midst of such a vicious white supremacist empire was to take all of that hatred and terror and trauma and translate it into the greatest modern tradition of any peoples in terms of spiritual fortitude and moral witness. I don't know of a people in the modern world who have been hated the way we have and still teach the world so much about love. And it's more in our music than anything else. But the music has always been paradigmatic of what we've been as a people in terms of our highest standards. So that we pushed in the gutter, we don't want everybody in the gutter, we want everybody out. Ida B. Wells, you've been terrorized, you don't want to terrorize back, you want freedom for everybody. That's a moral and spiritual ground. We got that in part because of the history of the best of the black church.
Yes.
Now black Christians have no monopoly on goodness. There's been black Muslims to do magnificent things. There's been black Buddhists to do magnificent things. There's been black atheists and agnostics who have done wonderful things when they had integrity, honesty, vision, courage, and willingness to fight for freedom across the board. But what has happened in the last 40 years is a massive spiritual breakdown in black America. So we have been willing to reduce our greatness, which was always moral and spiritual, to success, which is now material. And somewhere out there, what does it gain a people to gain the whole world and lose your soul? What happens when the things that really nourish your soul and your children, you're willing to give up just for a mess of pottage? And this is not individual, this is a structural and institutional thing in black America. So when you look at our churches,
I was not kidding when I said Willie P. Cook, J. Alfred Smith. These were pastors. They were not CEOs. They weren't in it for money. They believed what they said. They said what they believed. They were tender. They were kind. They were sweet.
Yes.
They were gentle.
Yes.
On the individual level. Just like a solo by David Ruffin. The sweetness and the gentleness in that genius from Why Not Mississippi singing with the Temptations, with Eddie Kiffin from Birmingham in the background and Otis Radio and his voice and those voices coming together to try to provide some gentleness for souls of a people who've been taught to hate themselves.
That's
right. Well, that's just one example of it. That's what our choir used to be. That's different than a praise team.
Hallelujah.
Because the choir opens itself up and gives of what is on the inside to empower and uplift you for that next week. It's not to titillate and stimulate you and everybody to say, oh, they sounded so good. Oh, they know it's not about them. It's about God and Spirit working through them to empower them in such a way that they are bringing in service to people who are on the edge of life of this. Barely make it in the week. If you don't hit that note right, they might snap.
That's it.
We got a whole bunch of young folk these days, and I love them to death, but a lot of them can't even sing in tune. They making millions of dollars.
Right.
Bobby McKay and Jack King Cole and Luther Vandross and Donny Hathaway turning over in their grave. Sing in tune. This ain't about making money. Music is sacred for people who have to hold on to the notes in order to live. This ain't no game. This ain't no career. This ain't no money-making game. You are a servant. You've been called. You've been anointed to sing those songs. Same is true for the preacher and the deacons and the trustees and the folk in the congregation and the artists and the intellectuals. Marvin X has been a servant. He's willing to give. He ain't playing no game. He's already told you his downs. He can tell you his ups.
That's right.
And he can tell you the love that's come in so many different forms that has helped sustain him. And we know that his love for us in so many different forms has helped sustain us. That's why we're here tonight.
We're going to stand in the ovation.